Welcome to our event tonight. An event, as you can see, in a kind of special constellation, which might be also kind of a reenactment of one of a very original Greek scene, a scene that is somehow even connected to the original European thinking. You probably know that I'm referring to Platon's Symposium. A situation like the one that we might have tonight. So I would like to ask you to take water or wine to drink and later to eat, because this is going to be kind of dinner discussion, so it should be just in between our guests, but in between everybody here around the table. Funny thing about the symposium is that, Platon's symposium, is that when they started their symposium, they decided not to drink. I don't know if you know about it. And that was because they were completely drunk the night before. So Socrates and Alcibiades and Agathon, they decided not to drink and to talk about love, actually. Very interesting topic. I don't know if we will come across it tonight. But yeah, that's true. But it gives us already like two ideas. One idea is it started in Athens, and the other idea is it started from a terrible hangover, which might be an inspiration for us tonight. But I can assure you the wine is really good, so please serve yourself. My name is Jakob. I'm program director in the Goethe Institute in Athens. I'm completely mixed already. And I'm very happy that we came together for this event tonight, an event that is for many reasons important for us at the Goethe Institute in Prague, because it somehow a shift, it's a very important moment for us. Whereas in the years before, we were very very fixed on German and Czech topics. We recently opened up our kind of program lines and programmatic ideas more towards other cities, other countries, other topics. And of course, you can imagine that these topics are all related somehow to contemporary art, culture, activism, but also to other more political topics, such as migration and crisis situations. We somehow realized that it's not enough to talk about these topics in bilateral situation, like to invite some important experts and to discuss with them on a kind of bilateral basis, but it's more important to kind of involve people and experts and activists and actors from different cities, different countries. So we came up with this idea that the whole program starting from 2016 should not be a German-Czech program, but should be kind of reflecting something which someone called world mentality, like to keep in mind that all these situations and conditions that we are in are always to be reflected kind of transnationally, translocally. We started this kind of programmatic shift with some events around Ukraine, so we invited activists from Donbas in Crimea and talked with them about their situation in this crisis regions of eastern and southern Ukraine. And in the end of the year and next year, we will go even further and we will try to change our institute completely. Not so much visibly, but we want to invite our institutes from Beirut and from Cairo, from Damascus, and from Amman in Jordan, to take over our business here. So we invite them to make our work in a way like a carte blanche, and we have to give someone the mandate and the resources to just transfer one place into another one. So we will see if this experiment will really work. I'm quite excited by the idea to have a big sign in Arabic letters here in Prague, writing Goethe Institute. I think it will definitely create some awareness. And somehow in between, this idea came up to do something on Athens. There is many lines leading to this table actually, and one very important line is sitting just across of me. It's Susanna and the Ara Collective, who actually is already since a few weeks or a few months doing this import-export, this exchange between these two cities of Prague and Athens, and they do it quite intensively, and I think all of us have already somehow participated in this exchange in one way or the other. And I'm happy that we decided to become part of this exchange and to create this event together tonight. And this event is in a way accompanying an exhibition that will open the day after tomorrow, Wednesday. It's an exhibition curated by Anne Kirschner, who herself is the best agent of this movement between Prague and Germany, Athens, because she herself is German, living in Athens, and doing a show that is that has one person, Esther Kumbachova, who is very important for the Prague context. So we see there is a lot of lines coming together in this exhibition as well. In the show there is a few artists from Germany, from Czech Republic, and from Greece as well, and one of the collectives that is being shown in this exhibition is Nova Melancholia, a performance collective from Athens, and at least, I guess, three members of Nova Melancholia are here on the table. Two of them. I will only introduce you to Vasilis Moulas next to me, who is a founding member of Nova Melancholia. It's not his only collective. I can tell you that there is a few more situations or constellations that he's working in, and we will come to that later. Vasilis is born in New York and has a degree in drama studies and performing arts from Paris and Athens, and fine arts in Athens as well, so very interdisciplinary. And he's actually not invited to this symposium or to this table as a member of Nova Melancholia. This is his part in the exhibition at the Umgallerie, but here he is as a member of a movement called Green Park. You can see it here. You can actually also see what it is. We'll come back to it later, but it's kind of social cultural center in a former pavilion in a park in Athens. And I'm stop it here because I know that we will talk about this later. We have two other guests here, and I will start with Nadia Agropoli. Nadia is a curator, an independent curator from Athens. Independent. And working together with big institutions as well, private institutions, public institutions. You might have seen her on her lecture a few weeks ago in the Art Academy in Umbrun, and we are happy that you came back to Prague, you joined us tonight. You have been working with the main private foundations and collections and museums in Athens and in Greece, with the most important curators, I have to say, like Hans-Ulrich Hobist and Massimiliano Giorgi and Maurizio Catalan. So, but I think this won't be the topic of the talk tonight, of our conversation tonight. More important is probably one project that you that recently we received in the end of our small discussion, the Wealth Shift Project, dealing a lot with minorities in religious minorities and ethnic minorities in Athens. And this brings me to my last guest, Juliane Stegner, a very dear colleague of mine. She's the program director of the Goethe Institute in Athens. We will hear more about the Goethe Institute and its activities in Athens later, but I think it's a very interesting moment even for me to have Juliane here as a kind of partner in a discussion, because it's not a very normal situation at the Goethe Institute. We are very egoistic in a way. Everybody is staying in his country or in her country and doing program in her country, and I'm very happy that Juliane was as open as to travel to Prague and to present us the work of the Goethe Institute linked to the topics of tonight. Okay, I hope you have something to drink. I see a lot of closed bottles, but maybe you will be less shy later. We have a lot of topics tonight, a lot of important topics tonight, and we are going to shift through a lot of topics tonight. And the idea was that we will start with a more, let's say, official part, which will be a conversation between the four of us. And then we would serve some first round of food, finger food, and have the discussion more openly with all of you. And afterwards we will have like soup and salad, and we can discuss more really completely informally, then maybe with the wine. So we decided to start to give you a kind of heavy intro with a film played from YouTube, and a film with the name, a very nice name, A Fiasco at Megalon. We somehow came up with the idea that the topic of fiasco could be kind of meta title for the whole event tonight. So we will start with The Fiasco at Megalon. And we won't see the whole clip. Just a few minutes, and yeah, we can begin and start with it. And we will need sound as well.
Οι άλλων χωρών της Μέσης Ανατολής έχουν αποδείξει ότι η γυραιά Ήπειρος σε αυτά που προσπάθησε και προσπαθεί σε ό,τι αφορά την οικονομία και την παραγωγική της βάση έχει μείνει σε αρκετά πίσω. Το κόστος εργασίας, μία σειρά από άλλοι παράγοντες, έχουν καταστήσει πολλούς κλάδους της ευρωπαϊκής οικονομίας μη ανταγωνιστικούς, δηλαδή απλά μη βιώσιμους. Οι ευρωπαϊκές χώρες, η κάθε μια ξεχωριστά, αλλά τώρα πια στο πλαίσιο της ευρωπαϊκής οικογένειας, είναι υποχρεωμένες να αναζητήσουν εναλλακτικές διαδικασίες παραγωγής που να έχουν το χαρακτήρα της ανταγωνιστικότητας. Μία από αυτές. Μου επιτρέπετε να συνεχίσω.
Θεωρώ ότι οι αναλογίες με την Ελλάδα υπάρχουν και παραλύζεται κι αυτός από τέτοιου προβλήματα. Στην Ελλάδα, εν προκειμένου, ο πολιτισμός δεν είναι μόνο η εθνική μας ταυτότητα και η εθνική μας περιφάλεια. Στην Ελλάδα, ελάτε πάνω να μας τα πείτε. Είναι εύκολος ο συνδικαλισμός από κάτω. Και είναι εύκολος ο συνδικαλισμός και η λοφραγωγία όταν εκθέτει τη χώρα και την εικόνα της σε μια τέτοια εκδήλωση. Είναι εύκολος ο συνδικαλισμός και η λοφραγωγία. Ελάτε πάνω, ορίστε έναν εκπρόσωπο και ελάτε πάνω. Εσείς που μηδενίζετε και εξαλείφετε τα πάντα, ελάτε πάνω. Να έχετε το θάρρος του δημοσίου λόγου. Εγώ εκτίθεμαι ενώπιόν σας με αυτά που λέω και με αυτά που υφίσταμε σε επίπεδο αποδοκιμασιών από εσάς. Ελάτε πάνω λοιπόν να λάβετε τον λόγο και να πάρουμε μέρος σε μια συζήτηση. Να συζητήσουμε για θέματα που αφορούν τη χώρα, την κοινωνία μας. Να διαφωνήσουμε. Να διασταυρώσουμε επιχειρήματα. Όχι φωνές και αποδοκιμασίες παλαιοσυνδικαλιστικής νοοτροπίας.
Είναι πολιτική
πράξη αυτό που κάνω εγώ, όχι αυτό που κάνετε εσείς, η οκλαβογία. Και είναι ντροπή αυτό που κάνετε. Και δεν σας επιτρέπετε να αναμπρώνετε για λόγους συνδικαλιστικούς μια τέτοια εκδήλωση. Έχετε ευθύνες για αυτά που γίνονται εδώ μέσα. Είναι ντροπή σας. Ντροπή σας είναι. Οφείλετε, καθίστε κάτω κυρία μου, να έχετε το θάρρος, καθίστε εδώ να μιλήσετε, καθίστε κάτω. Θέλετε να μετατρέψετε μια εκδήλωση για την ελληνική προεδρία σε οχλαγωγία συνδικαλιστών της αριστεράς. Αρκετά. Αυτά να τα πείτε στις συνελεύσεις του ΣΥΡΙΖΑ και των Αστία. Όχι εδώ. Όποιος θέλει να έχει δημόσιο λόγο, να δει και να τον πάρει. Όχι με οχλαγωγία. Θυμίζετε με νανοσύντονες με τη συγκεκριμένη αντίδρασή σας. Δεν θυμάται τη χώρα. Και κυρίως δεν θυμάται το Υπουργείο το οποίο καλούμε θα όλοι να επιεπίσουμε. Σταματήστε λοιπόν. Σας βλέπω κύριε με αυτά που κάνετε. Σας βλέπω ότι γίνεται της οχλαγωγίας. Δεν σας θυμάμαι προσωπικά. Όποιος θέλει να έχει δημόσιο λόγο, να αρθεί να το πάρει εδώ το δημόσιο λόγο. Και να μιλήσει. Αλλά δεν θα μετατρέψετε την εκδήλωση της ελληνικής προεδρίας σε μια εκδήλωση οχλαγωγίας και τη χρήση εκδίκησης ακραίων συνδικαλιστικών ετοιμάτων. Είναι ντροπή αυτό που γίνεται από ορισμένους. Δεν σας θυμάει ούτε ο συνδικαλιστές, ούτε ο στελέχη συγκεκριμένων κομμάτων της αριστεράς. Πρέπει να μάθετε να στέλνετε τη χώρα. Δεν επιτρέπονται όλα στη χώρα. Όταν σε αυτό το σημείο έχετε φτάσει στη σημερινή εκδήλωση. Σας διαβεβαιώ ότι σας περιμένω στο βήμα. Περιμένω εσάς κύριε που λέτε σώπα, οχυρωμένος πίσω από την ανωνυμία του συνδικαλιστικού πλήθους που εκπροσωπείτε. Πρέπει να μάθετε ότι η δημοκρατία αποτελείται από πολίτες και οι πολίτες πρέπει να έχουν ονοματεπώνυμο και άποψη υπεύθυνη. Όχι να κρύβονται πίσω από ένα συνδικαλιστικό πλήθος για να προκαλούν προβλήματα. Δεν μπορείτε να πείτε τίποτα. Μόλις τελειώσω, θα έχετε το λόγο.
μόλις τελειώσω, θα έχετε το λόγο. Αλλά δεν θα μετατρέψουμε αυτή την εκδήλωση. Κυρία Βασιλείου, ζητώ την κατανόησή σας. Είναι φαινόμενα που συμβαίνουν δυστυχώς και στη χώρα μας αυτή την περίοδο. Δεν τιμούν τη χώρα, αλλά κυρίως αδικούν και τιμούν αυτούς που τα κάνουν. Αγαπητοί φίλοι, εσείς που φωνάζετε, μου επιτρέπετε μια κουβέντα. Θα καθίσετε ένα λεπτό με υπομονή να σας πω κάτι. Είναι, κυρία Βασιλείου, θέλω να εκφράσω τη λύπη μου για την εικόνα αυτή. Με τους συνδικαλιστές μας θα μπορέσουμε να συζητήσουμε και θα τα βρούμε. Αλλά αφήστε τα όλα αυτά. Είστε διάκριτοι και διάκριτες. Αφήστε τα τώρα αυτά. Και αυτά δεν γίνονται μόνο στο Υπουργείο Πολιτισμού. Γίνονται και αλλού. Ντροπή σε εσάς, κύριε. Διότι κατευθύνεστε από συγκεκριμένο κόμμα και από συγκεκριμένη πολιτική ομάδα. Ντροπή σε εσάς. Ντροπή που μετατρέπετε μια εκδήλωση και οδηγείτε στον αρκετή χώρα κατά αυτόν τον τρόπο. Αλλά ευτυχώς η πλειοψηφία του ελληνικού λαού δεν εκφράζεται από εσάς. Ευτυχώς. Είμαι στη διάθεσή σας και το ξέρετε. Είμαι στη διάθεσή σας και το ξέρετε. Είναι ντροπή να μετατρέπετε μια εκδήλωση που έχει ως σκοπό να τιμήσει την ελληνική προεδρία στην Ευρωπαϊκή Ένωση και να συζητήσει. Ναι, κυρία μου, εκδηλώστε την ιστορία σας. Εκδηλώστε τον ακραίο συνδικαλισμό σας. Δεν είναι τυχαίο που καταρτήσατε τον συνδικαλισμό εδώ που τον καταρτήσατε. Ντροπή σε εσάς. Σας βλέπω ποιοι είστε. Σας βλέπω ποιοι είστε. Δεν είσαστε καλλιτέχνες. Υπηρετείτε τον ανεξέλεγκτο θόρυβο.
Okay, we will stop it here as it gets a bit loud, even louder to the end of the clip. I like the fact that the whole event is called Enhancing Creativity, but maybe Nadia, maybe you could give us some idea who is this hysteric syndicalist that we can hear in the background, and who is this poor guy on the stage?
Okay. First of all, you must break the bottles open, because as I read here, the very word fiasco comes from the breaking of the bottle, or whoever fails pays for the next bottle. So it's a good time to open the bottle and drink something now. And just to give you a brief background, we are at the heroic moment of February 2014, then, when Greece is having again the presidency of the European Union for 6 months. So this is one of the inaugural events of the presidency, and every presidency wants to demonstrate the best that it has. And unfortunately, one of the best that were chosen to be demonstrated was the reality of culture in Greece at the moment. And this reality was a harsh one. Again, unfortunately, the Greek government then, a right government, hence you hear, yes, you are right, which is a play with you are correct and also you are off the right. So there are several plays in this discussion over. And Panos Panagiotopoulos, the then Minister of Culture, is giving this speech. The speech is centered around the theme of financing creativity. We should remember that there were at least 71 new legislations that passed then, and all had to do with the deeper connection of the EU and the Eurozone, growth, jobs, cohesion. So culture was dragged into this context at this event. The collective, one of the collectives that this shape-shifting guy here was part of, the Mavili collective, is the collective that also made the Ebros squad, the Ebros theater squad. They entered, they were already the Megaro, and they had decided, and Vasilis will tell us more of how this happened, to counteract this because, and I'm reading from one of the things that the collective said later, and it is posted online. The General Secretary of the Minister of Culture, Elena Bendoni, has already also had a speech called Culture is Economy. And so the collective started laughing, also started answering back to the minister. The minister was infuriated, as you see. He kind of made all the wrong moves and all the mistakes from, again, addressing a female as hysteric, and we know how long this goes back to, and all the other things. And eventually this went online, became viral. It was one of the most eloquent protests against a discussion, a public discussion, a European-related discussion that did not involve the people that it should involve, the artists. No one was asked to be there. These were funny times. I could go on along. There was a history by then of several groups attacking politicians in places all over Athens. So there may be some background there that you don't get when you just see that. But as always, it is an interesting subject to dig deeper into. The Mavili Collective then wrote this part that is online that says that we decided to be there, to do this action, because this was a vision of culture that shows that the Greek state abandons contemporary culture and intends to fund private institutions which will then form Greece's cultural landscape. And as far as a laugh is concerned, what we will be saying in a minute is how Greece is now completely run by private foundation. So maybe the laugh is on all of us in the end. I'm just saying, but let's hear it from the person who was directly involved.
We were very happy with this action. It was very successful, and we we were very much enjoying it because it was risky. And we gathered around 40 people. We had the plan that in a certain moment cost us a guy. We have started to laugh, and then we all follow. And our strategy was that we were placed in the middle, so that the secret police couldn't reach us easily, and that laughing is not insulting. It's nothing. We had decided not to speak. The people who spoke were not, many of them were not from us. Most people that are from the audience are people from the audience that we didn't know. We had decided not to speak, not to enter to a dialogue with him, and of course not insulting, nothing like that. And two guys were illegally recording, that's why it's so badly recorded. And what was very effective is that the same night we did the editing and the translating in English subtitles, and it was on the next morning. And this was very effective. And then we tried to go again, because this was a series of talks, and the safety rules had completely changed, and we couldn't enter anymore to the conferences, because it was only with list, and also they said that the conference is going to be, for example, at the Acropolis Museum, and last minute they changed the place and they in another museum, etc. Very that, but that proved that it was so effective. And official media silenced the event because also the minister was an old journalist, so he had all the media with him, and only through the net it was it became viral. For me, it's very revealing also the what you said, all the stereotypes that he was completely deteriorized, and he started to repeating all the stereotypes. One of the nice stereotypes of the, from this government is that the left and the extreme right is the same thing. So he says you are from the left, and next sentence he says you remind me of fascists. You are like fascists. So this was a very cliché, because they were afraid of the Syriza that was going to go in the end. They were trying to do that. Or again, they were another cliché is that to blame syndicalism. And everything that has to do with the state and with and syndicalism, etc. What else? Yeah, I think it was the peak of our career. I don't know if it's the moment to say more or
not. One short question. Who left before? You or the minister? I mean, who left the stage or the space?
We won. He left. At the end of the clip, we can see him. He couldn't complete the speech, and he left the room. So yeah, and then we were very much afraid how we were going to leave the building. But it was okay.
So maybe this would be the right moment to introduce us a bit to the artistic and activist scene in Athens, because we have already heard about at least three collectives, three groups that you are involved in. Maybe you could give us a short overview, a short insight into what is happening at the moment in Athens, like which groups are active.
Maybe Nadia could say things about the landscape. I can say my paradigm. And so the first thing, we came together with the Mapili Collective, which was artists from theater and performance practice, and we came together in 2010. And at that time, the crisis was beginning to show the length of it and the depth of it. And we had in the theater in Greece, we used to have state subsidies every year. It was a very nice system. And that system collapsed around 2010. And we came together to deal with our common problems in the field of performance and theater and dance. And we tried to organize a series of conferences on cultural policy, and we tried to enter to a dialogue with the Ministry of Culture. We were inviting them to come, and they did came. But they did come, but it was very difficult in that time because the one government was falling after the other. It was this time that we changed a lot of governments, and finally we had a president that was not elected by the people, but just to run the country, a bureaucrat. And so it was this, at this moment, everything was collapsing concerning the state. So it was very difficult because every some months the Minister of Culture was changing. Well, it was something, somebody else all the time. And we quickly understood that there is no hope of, there's not hope wanting to have a cultural policy from the state at that moment. And so after a year, we decided to do something more radical, and we did the squat, the Ambrose Theatre squat. And after some years, we decided to go more radical and do activist things like the Megaron fiasco. And then we were very tired and we spread, because this is the
eventually
this is the story.
Sometimes.
And then, yeah.
So I think we will talk more about Ambrose Theatre and Green Park later. I just wanted to also involve again Nadia and Juliane, because here is something at stake. We see that the Minister of Culture left the stage. This is somehow very symbolic for the situation that we all know, at least from media, from Greece, the public sphere, the public sector is somehow weak, or let's say even collapsing. We have different forms and different layers of crisis, starting from economic, financial crisis towards a political crisis, and now since a few months, a very heavy humanitarian crisis. Under such conditions, how do institutions work? How is the interplay between public institutions, the public sector, is it still there? Is it still visible, at least in the cultural field, in the cultural sphere? And how is the relation to the private cultural institutions? And I would like to ask this question to all the three of you, because you come from different standpoints, different perspectives, like you working as an independent curator with public and private institutions, you being active in different collectives and very critical collectives, and Juliane as a representative of a non-Greek public institution. So maybe we will start with the non-Greek public institution. How do you consider, how do you see this whole landscape in Greece?
Yes, I'm looking at it as an outside observer, of course. And I realize that there are at the moment two existing stereotypes describing the situation in Athens. One is ancient ruins meet the ruins of neoliberalism. And the other is, Athens has become a workshop for creativity. There's a huge energy in the art field. And I would say none of these stereotypes are true. If you see to the art scene, I think there you can see a lot of exploitation and exhaustion. And it's only often labeled as creativity. And I would say this is an empty signifier for the situation at the moment in essence. So if the art scene is not supported at all by the state or the municipality, and there's no support, you don't have, only you can't breathe, and you have to look after your life and your living, and how can you produce in such a situation? And of course, then there are foundations and foreign institutions come into the field, and I feel sometimes for us and also for the joining artists and curators, it's not so easy, this situation, then collaborating with the institutions.
But you are representing a very specific country in Greece. Sorry to say that.
Yes. Yes.
I would be really interested, I mean, through this last years, we know that...
Yeah.
Maybe you could refer to this very specific institutional situation that you are in as a German institution.
Okay, with the crisis and the neoliberalism and the austerity policy, of course, and the history, also Germany and Greece is having up during the Second World War and all this time. So, Germans are not so loved anymore. If they were ever, I don't know. But luckily, in this, what we realized in this situation was the Goethe Institute is, in essence, was founded in 1952. That means that was the first foundation abroad, all over the world, and all my predecessors. Where I'm standing on the shoulders of them, so they made a very good job. So we were not touched by this political discussions around us. And we could realize it, it was 3 years ago, we were celebrating our 60th anniversary in essence. And the first time of the institute, we went out with a PR strategy and saying joining and enjoying and whatever. And in the middle of all that, Mrs. Merkel came to Athens, and we said, "Oh, might be this will cause some problems." And we were very, very happy that we couldn't realize in the press any connection of the politics with the work of the Goethe Institute, and also some people really were supporting us, saying that's not a German institution, that's a part of Athens. So,
Nadia, you are working with different private collectors and institutions.
Mm-hmm.
They are becoming stronger and stronger.
Let me start from the institutional part. My years of of remorse. I started my career as a director of cultural programming of the Hellenic American Union. The Hellenic American Union was also founded in 1957. But it was a big difference in the sense that it collaborated with the American embassy, but it was founded by Greeks, by some of the most educated Greeks of the time. So these are times that the Greek people are again looking upwards, and the foreign people are looking inwards, the alien gaze we talked about with some of you that you were in Athens, and the gaze was reciprocal. It was okay, and it was fair at its best. Now, for the Greeks, who like conspiratory theories, all these institutions are cover-ups for spies. And in any case, they are somehow true. Yeah. And somehow, they are even ways for cultural hegemony, like imposing culture. Of course, we all know that things, look at what the Americans did in the Easter, sometimes people do not plan, things happen. So it happened for many years, and at some points, like during the junta period, which means during the periods of the where there was not freedom in Greece and all of that, the cultural institutions were very important because it was there that people could show things, artists made some really great exhibits and so on. Now, as the politics change and as history changes, so they go up and down in our minds, in our hearts, and in how they affect everybody. So they become part of this very complex narrative now. So going back to the fiasco situation, since the first years of crisis, we have a series of fiascos. And the fiascos continue up to now, where we have fiascos with ministers of culture of the left government. Even bigger fiascos, because when they fail better on the left. So what is happening now is, as I said before, that we fought so that culture is not becoming an economy, and it is becoming the bigger economy ever now. Which means there is no funding whatsoever from the Greek Ministry of Culture, not even the funding that then existed for theater and dance and cinema. There is still a center of the film center, let's say, that funds some movies, but everything is extremely complicated. Sometimes, you know, the superpower, the vigilant eye of its government is over there. So the field is wide open, more open than ever, to the private institutions. Is that too bad? Let's see. Because I know that there are several arguments raised from the actors about this. So, private institutions. NEO Foundation, founded by collector Dimitris Daskalopoulos, a very big collector, who also used to be had a company of his own, one of the biggest. So he was kind of the ultimate capitalist, let's say. He has, after he left the business, sold his business, he became a very powerful actor in the art field. He founded NEO. Almost everybody is being funded by NEO money now, because they have this project of giving small amounts of money to many people. They make a very good program. Most of it is also quite radical, activist-oriented, claiming the field of the city, the urban sector, doing whatever the civil sector is not doing, even though they're not saying that this is part of our program, right? They're saying we are interested in public space. And so we are very much interested in performance, for example. They brought Marina Abramovic over, but they also organized a series of events, like some of the events that you will see today with Actopolis, that Gede is involved. The people running them are also people who are getting funds through NEO. So here is a powerful actor taking over. Then it's the Onassis Foundation that has made a huge building, perfect situation for all kinds of performances, theater, the best, and they are also funding fine arts projects. So again, whatever major we see in terms of theater and dance, and we see it over there through choices they make. They have a very good curatorial, and some of the people that are here are also involved in this. So again, very complex. Then the Niarchos Foundation. The Niarchos Foundation is the richest one of the billionaire families that came out of Greece. They have their bases outside of Greece, but now they're funding the biggest program ever in recent Greek history. They have built the new opera house, which is also going to house the public library of Greece. Needless to say, they funded everything with the aim to give everything over to the Greek state. Imminent, 2017, maybe. We are all scared shitless with the possibility that the Greek state will take over. You know, because we've seen what they have done with whatever they have taken over. That's the foundation. That's the foundation founded by Dakis Ioannou, was one of the biggest world collectors, is not funding projects, is doing projects that have to do with the collection itself, but it is the first, 1985, So it really shaped the field. Also, they are doing the Deste Prize for upcoming Greek artists, and they are bringing over major theorists, museum people to view over the sea. So again, a major player. Now, we also have this very strange situation with museums that are somehow funded by the state, very little money now, but are private museums. The Benaki, the Cycladi, they are doing not only events related to their collection, like, for example, Byzantine art or architecture, but also contemporary art events. They are filling in the gap that we had because we didn't have a museum of contemporary art. So, more complex again. So, what I'm trying to describe is a field like nothing you're accustomed to. Do not make the assumption that you can know this scene by knowing in general what happens with institutions in other countries, what happens with players in other countries. Things are changing, and the change is precipitated very much by the crisis. And what is, and of course, we have our para institution here, which is a kind of the new and dynamic players that are coming in out of genuine interest of what is happening. They are, it's like playing a billiard, you know, they are producing all these kinds of alternative moves within the billiard table, like the move we see tonight. And this is good because it comes from real concern and it involves everybody.
Thank you, Nadia. We should maybe take over the billiard game and play back to Vasilis, talking about para-institutions, talking about a third space where there is no public institution and probably no private money involved. Vasilis, could you tell us something about your beginnings with Emperor's Theater and kind of the development of your activities towards the Queen Park movement? And I think we have a new slide here, yeah, showing the roof of the Emperor's Theater.
Back in 2011, we decided to enter to this abandoned old theater that used to be a publishing house before becoming a theater, and then it was abandoned for like 5 or 7 years. And this is the nice sign that it has. And it's written Embrose, that means go ahead or avant-garde also. It has something nice like a name. And and we put this red star for the Christmas time it was. No, but okay, there are some rules when you want to make a squad, I found out, in Greece. It's better that the building belongs to the state. You should never squat a building that belongs to a private man because he will have problems. It's his property. But with the state in Greece, it's different. You can do it. Then, what we did like a strategy, because we were afraid that we will be kicked out, it was that we secretly had prepared a big festival with names not just from the avant-garde or our friends, but also from the mainstream artists, like our national choreographer, for example. So we had a nice program, and we did a press conference. When we did the squad the first day, we had organized a press conference and sending to the press that it's a secret location that will be revealed. So we play in a very contemporary way of advertising this. And this was a huge success with the press. And the rule is that when you take the press, it's okay with the politicians.
So,
yeah. So we had we were okay for 1 year. Nobody was coming. Very successful with the press and the artistic scene. Ambrose becoming a very hot spot. Of course, there were many problems, like we didn't know, we had planned only the 10 days, like a festival, etc. We weren't expected to stay longer, so we didn't know exactly how to continue. We were in a constant search of models of administration, of production, new ways of managing the a venue run by artists. So, yeah. And the big thing is that the rule in Greece is that squads are made by anarchists and not by artists. So maybe it was Ambrose was an exception. And we had very quickly to deal with anarchists that were they were claiming their way of doing things, and we refused that. And this was a big history. But to make it short, they respected that for 1 year. But then the situation in Greece changed again for the worse, and a big organization was created, the foreigners that give us money was demanding that. It is an organization that has all the power over the state, and the public property belongs to this organization, and this organization has the task to sell it. And the building was belonging now to this organization and not anymore to the ministry of I don't know what, and to the municipality or etc. And so now they wanted to kick us out to sell the building because they had found somebody to buy it. And there are a lot of funny stories. For example, it happened that I learned who this person was. It was an old actor that wanted to buy this and to make his house for his theater. And I publicly named him in a newspaper. Like, he wants to take the theater from the squad, etc. And he retrieved the offer. So again, we had peace with the organization that wanted to sell the building. But anyway, police entered, and I am on trial, me and other four guys, for years now, because it keeps postponing. And my next trial is at the end of June, and we don't know if we will be to present or not present. We have a special lawyer that is specialized in cases like that.
But they are on strike now, the lawyers.
Not Mrs. Kurtovic.
Ah, Mrs. Kurtovic.
Yes. And
yeah, an exception.
So and then to make it short, we were very much we were asked by the police and etc. to leave the place, and we made an open call to collectives and anarchists and parties like Syriza, etc. to support us. And they came, and it was successful. We remained, the squad remained, but it had to swift model. And the anarchy model predominated. That means that the General Assembly every Sunday started, an open General Assembly. And swift of the orientation, because we were artists and wanted to experiment with the form and the art. And anarchists are not very fond of art in general, and when they do art, they want it to be clear and to have a clear meaning, etc. And so little by little and all the situation, but it's very interesting, like a process. And for me, it took one more year with them in order to really quit, exhausted, the place. That, and now it continues, and it's run by this General Assembly, and I am truly happy that it still exists.
But it was not only the anarchists that took over.
Well,
it was generally more politically oriented. And,
yeah, it was some parties. Syriza and Narcia also, yeah, we had this, yeah.
So,
true.
We've got a small video clip again here.
Or across, yeah, to see the space a bit.
Yeah, so maybe we can start the video clip.
It's a bit funky. This is the Mavili collective that we were.
Εντάξει. Οκ. Ή 9.30 θα δούμε. Εντάξει.
Πιστεύω θα τη βρούμε τη λύση.
Πόσο γρήγορα.
Πολύ γρήγορα.
Πόσο γρήγορα.
Πολύ γρήγορα.
Πόσο γρήγορα.
Πολύ γρήγορα.
Να λέμε σε άλλο καφέ εδώ.
Τι να κάνει. Αυτό είναι η έξοδος.
Καλό.
Δημητρά.
Καλό.
Δημητρά.
Καλό.
Καλό.
A friend of us did this video, a bit funky, but imagine the gap between this and the anarchist, the aesthetics. Yeah. Even for me, it's a bit.
Could we have the next slide, please? Because it brings us directly to the title of the talk tonight, which is Green Park. Green Park is quite recent, a kind of newcomer to the Athens art scene and performance scene. And maybe you could introduce us to this kind of new space.
Yeah, we entered in this space last year, last summer, 2015. This was an old cafe restaurant in a big park in the center of Athens, abandoned again, belonging to the state, to the municipality. And now, because of Syriza, the left wannabe government, they tolerate us unofficially. They like the image that there are bottom-up initiatives and collectives and things like that. So, yeah. This is a big difference because with Gross we had problems finally with the state. Here we don't have problems with the state. They even supporting us in an unofficial way, which is a very big difference. And the other big difference is that we learned from something from the Gross experience. And this time we wanted to not to be very concrete and concrete group of people. So Green Park is a very loose collective of people. Led also is with us there, collaborating with many artists, and it's not a closed group. And the Mabil Collective is not active anymore. But many of the people who did the squad of Green Park, we were met during the Ambrose activation. And yeah. And the nice thing is I can read a bit the manifesto. Today, on the 19th of June 2015, we are occupying Green Park Cafe in the Pedion του Άρεως, one of the two central parks of Athens, almost 4 years after the occupation of the Ambrose Theatre in 2011. We are activating with our own means a space deserted and left empty for years by the Greek state, and propose a 10-day program of cultural and political intervention in the here and now of Athens. The activation refuses a particular temporal horizon and understands itself outside of the logics of our ownership. The occupation is not defined by a particular ideology or interest, but rather comes about as a result of the encounters born out of the experiments and struggles of the last few years. Thus, we look to rebuild modes of collectivity and solidarity, and reclaim friendship for its political importance. We propose friendship as a model of organizational formations and autonomous instituting that exceeds neoliberal calls to order. And it continues. So, yeah, the key idea was the friendship and the joy, because also this was a cafe and a place also that people were gathering to dance and to eat. We also wanted something that joy and friendship as a counterpart for politics.
I think such examples like Green Park and Ambrose Theatre brings us to the next topic of our talk, which would be the informal practices that are going on in Athens at the moment. And one project that was recently founded by the Temporary Academy of Arts, it's the so-called soft power lectures, use this kind of informal spaces in the city, not only abandoned spaces, but also spaces in function. And I will ask Juliane to shortly introduce us to this new project in Athens, or this new methodology in Athens.
The self-power lectures, as they called, they are curated by Elpida Karamba, and they had she has founded this in 2013, and it's now a part of a bigger project which we are conducting with seven countries and eight cities. I will talk about it a little bit later. This bigger project is called Actopolis, like action, the art of action. And within this project, Elpida and her team, they are acting along institutions or with institutions, not squatting spaces, but might be preparing mental spaces for squatting or whatever. It's called the Temporary Academy of Arts. And what they do, it's an educational artistic project that develops, as I say, para-institutional actions, meaning, as a part of the cultural machinery. And within the project, they did six productions, so we have to call it productions, in several spaces. For example, they did a lecture in the university, in the Academy of Arts, together with the students. They did an intervention in a western part of Athens, in Menidi, Achanes, a very difficult part of the city, where they did also lecture intervention there. And they did one, I have, Elpida gave me a video with, I just want to describe it a little bit before we see some interviews. It was, it took place in a cafe on the main square, Omonia Square, in a public cafe. And they invited people from the art scene, and they did 10 interviews, always the same questions, and they are recording these questions and do a film out of it, or later on do educational material out of it, to describe also how the art scene is responding to the situation in essence, and as I said, as an educational tool in a state where I would say the education for the art or for the audience is not really existing when I compare it with other European countries. They were asking, what we see, there are the two co-directors of the Athens Biennale, Kokayo and Xenia, they are the first one. We can see when there is Sebaka Agiyamia, she is the heading director of the educational program of the Documenta 14. And a very well-known filmmaker, Konstantinos Yanagis, who took it in a very interesting way, the questions, just to get an impression how they are working.
Γεωγραφικά. Disciplines, national boundaries, and cultural differences.
And in this project, there are participating more than 60 curators, artists, activists, urban planners, architects, experts explore their possibilities in their urbanistic practice. And the questions are, what can we learn about the future of the city, social and spatial reality? And how can cities and their inhabitants act in terms of social, economic and political instability? Taking part is Turkey with two cities, Ankara and Mardin, and Croatia, Serbia, Bosnia, Romania, Greece with Athens. And Germany. It's part of a three-year project, and now we are in the second year. And I think there's an interesting website, a blog-based website, where you can find, might be we go immediately to the participants. There are more than 60 participants, as I said, and they have the filter with the city. You can find out in which city who is acting and the functions, meaning curators, artists, or co-curators. And projects, at the moment, there are more than 43 projects in the seven countries. And there's also a filter with the city and Athens with the soft power lectures is one project in the framework of the right side is if you click on it, it's highlighted now. You can learn about more about the project, and there's also, as I said, a blog function. And what it's what very important in within this project is for us also this physical exchange between the curators and the artists. And as Jakob mentioned in the beginning, we are also a regional institute, and we are not only dealing in a dialogue, Germany, Greece. Luckily, we are also able to conduct huge projects with many countries. And regarding the funds, there's a big partner in Germany called Urbane Künste Ruhr. And that's funded by the state of North Rhine-Westphalia, and so the funding for the Goethe part we had to apply at the head office many times. Okay. Thank you.
I'm coming somehow to the last and very open topic of the discussion today. And it's somehow related to what you described with the project. It's about a mingling of people, not really in a city, but bringing people together from different places, from different cities. And we were discussing this topic with Nadia, preparing this discussion. And it was, for you, the notion of mingling was somehow very important, especially in relation to the way how the documenta approaches a city like Athens or a topos like Athens. Maybe you could shortly reenact this discussion that we had a few weeks ago.
Those of you that have been in my Umbrum lecture or even in Athens, you remember me making jokes. To go back to the original laughter part, how we started this discussion tonight, let me say something that I think is critical. There's this saying that goes that a joke that feeds on ignorance starves its audience. So every time there's a joke, anywhere, a joke on a government, a joke on a squad, a joke on a curator, on anybody, just be very suspicious of what the job is about and look deeply into the job, because there are always histories behind it, and every history leads to somewhere else. It's the mingling of the bodies. The body is also the body as the mind as well, not only the physical body. So this is what I'm referring to. So when Vasilis says, and when there are two Greeks in a table, they disagree, you should know that. When Vasilis says, we were run out of a bros, I know from an experience, the mingling of the bodies, that the artists were also run out of the bros because of the degeneration of politics. It was not just the anarchists, it was left politicians that took over. And this degenerated into a form of squat that didn't have space for the artists anymore. It was not joyful, as he said, because no matter what, when you are part of a, how can I say, a vision that really wants to change something or do something and not just, you know, quarrel about something, then you need to have joy, you need to have love, as he said in the beginning, or friendship. Mind you, the anarchists consider themselves like a form of friendship. So, very complicated things. So, in all of this very tense context, here comes the hyper-institution, Documenta. Documenta has this very nice idea, actually, and the curator of Documenta is Polish. So, he thinks of creating this very meaningful triangle. Let's say, so it's the couple and the lover in the middle, again very interesting. So we have Germany, we have Kassel, we have Athens, and Documenta is happening like the mirror, mirroring the two. The history of Germany and Greece is a long one, a painful one, an erotic one, a complex one. One that we could talk hours about. It involves archaeology, institutions, people, artists, you name it. We cannot be apart anymore. So here comes the third active agent, the Polish clever curator who will do the argument, will make the argument again. Mind you, Documenta every time has an exotic look. It looks somewhere, a city, anywhere, but it has never been in a city. So Adam Sitzmick has this idea of, and this working title, Learning from Athens. And they move, they open offices in Athens, they have a team, Goethe is helping facilitate the workings of the Documenta, they publish a magazine. They were in some kind of good terms with the Athens Biennale. Rumor has it they're not anymore. So again, more complex relationship with the actors, everybody, everywhere there. And so the principal argument now is the one that Pokaio from the Athens Biennale answered very quickly, and probably we didn't even notice, when they asked him, what do you have to say about exoticization? He said, it's okay, it is actually an opportunity. So, for this art scene that doesn't have money, it can only count on the generosity of the institutions, right? Or the, how can I say, the wolf made into a sheep of the state. You remember what Vasily said? The state lets us be in Green Park. They are the worst as far as culture and politics are concerned. I mean, even more austere, even more than anything that the right has done, but they let us be because they want to be associated with bottom-up movements. You see? So they use us. And we are allowing the use. We are allowing the exoticization, wherever it comes from, because it is probably the only game we have left. We are exhausted down to the ground and we have to keep on going. And we keep on going with whatever there is around. And sometimes what is around is honest, is genuine, is interesting. It makes us better because it is critical without being exclusive or conniving, right? But it is still this form of transaction. Now, we don't know what Documenta is going to be. It is probably because there are no known elements so far, but we know that there's not so much of a mingling of bodies. Juliane has a page from one of the graffitis that are now all around Athens are popping up because there are several anti-Documenta groups appearing. And there is this graffiti that says, "Dear Documenta, I refuse to exoticize myself to increase your cultural capital. Sincerely, Ithagenis." Ithagenis is like the pejorative term for the local people. So for the natives, let's say. And personally, I'm equally careful with this kind of simplification as I am with everything else that I said before. And the meaning of bodies, as far as I'm concerned, means do not assume that there is a Greek paradigm. There isn't. Or consider paradigm in the root of the word. Para, dai, and dai comes from dikhno. I saw something. I point to something. So instead of looking at where the finger points, look para, next to what the fingers point to. Because this is all the other things around are making the truth of it. And so Greek activism is nothing. It's an open city, you can squat everywhere, as he said, as long as it is a state thing, because nobody cares. And then there are other conditions at play there. So Documenta is one of them. We will see what will happen. The Greek paradigm is different than the Czech one. And my argument is that there is no such thing as a paradigm anymore. There is such a level of mobility and contingency and change all over that we should not assume that something looks like something else, or that we can find a recipe. No recipes. We can learn something if we do it the right way, by mingling, by getting involved, really involved, or we are ignorant without really nothing to give back.
Okay, Nadia, I take this as a final statement, of course.
I rest my case.
And I think we should come to the last part of our evening, which would be a common dinner that would be served here on the table. So I ask all of you who are sitting. Nadia, we still have this one. But maybe we can show it kind of during the evening. Yeah. Because
yeah,
it's already.
Yes,
yeah. So I would ask the ones who are not sitting at the table to join us at the table to mingle your hearts with us and to enjoy dinner. And I think we will stop the kind of public part here and continue with the more familiar one. And just let me thank to Nadia and to Juliane and Vasilis and the other members of Nova Melancholia for joining us. I know that it was not easy for them because they will just have the first performance on Thursday and Friday at 6 o'clock at the Boom Gallery, so be sure to be there. There is only 2 repetitions, so I hope that you will manage it, and now I will just enjoy it. Thank you very much.
Thank you.